Okay, I've come to do a little bit of skimmer fishing today. Sometimes in my job I get very lucky and I've had some really good testing sessions with the Ascension feeder rod. So today I was allowed to come out and do a nice little skimmer fishing video for you with the lighter, sort of the lower end, if you like, Ascension feeder rods, you know, the 3.2 meter, 3.4 meter, that sort of thing, you know, the shorter rods. So why I've picked this rod, I'm going to talk about, but before I do, I'm going to show you a little bit what I'm doing. I've done something quite interesting. I'm going to show them, Joe. I'm going to show them what I've done today because I think it's quite interesting. I've got, that is my normal.
Why is it green, mate?
Yeah, that's my normal F1 dark. And it's my normal F1 dark. So I'm just going to get this out of here. And I put some bait booster in it because when I came method fishing the other day with Jake, we caught loads of skimmers every time we put the bait booster on it. So I thought, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to pour some bait booster in. It's made it, because it's such a luminous yellow, it's made it that slightly greeny colour. And it's just made it a bit sweeter. And I've noticed when I chuck it in the water, a little bit of a yellow haze comes off it. So I thought, I'm going to have a go with that today, because why not? And it's working. We're catching loads of fish. So I've got a 20 gram little cage window. I've got a cage window on because it's really shallow. So it's like, it's only 3 foot, I reckon, where I'm fishing. So it's really shallow and I'm just literally dropping a maggot in, and then sometimes I squeeze it in hard, sometimes I squeeze it in soft, sometimes I give it one of those with a bit hanging out.
So you're not putting any worms or casters or
anything
like that?
It's too cold, Joe. It's too cold for, you know, this time of year I always think you want to ease off it, so it's too cold really. And then I've got my normal rig. I've got my
complicated simple
rig. I love braid. I'm a lad fish braid here, so I'm having a go with my braid today. A lot of places I've been going over winter, you have to fish mono. So I want to have a go with some braid. I've got a metre of 10 pound line. 10 pound this is. Brilliant. 028. I've got a little loop, and then I've got my 6-inch hook length from my 6-inch hook length box. And
so, hang on, let's just have a look at that, because the phone's struggling to focus a little bit. So, you've got braid.
Yeah.
Up until what, a metre?
Yeah, it's there.
Metre and a half?
Yeah, it's about one, it's just less than a metre and a half, about 1.2 metres.
So you've got 0.10 braid, is that?
0.08 braid.
0.08 braid?
Yeah, 0.10, 0.08, it doesn't matter.
So down to the shock leader?
Yeah.
Oh, is that a water knot?
A water knot, yeah, 3-turn.
So that comes all the way down?
Yeah.
To here? Yeah. What's going on here?
I've got one of our rubber stops that I've put on there, and when I'm casting slightly heavier feeders or punching into a wind, I just put a little stop on there as well for security. It's just a thing in my head. You could put two rubber stops on, but I like to put a little stop on and just nip it in place. Now the reason I've done that, let's continue with the rig, Joe. And then we've got this 10 pound line going all the way through, and then just a loop to loop. So I've got a 6-inch hook length.
So they are your pole hook lengths.
That's a pre-tied SFL to 011, 16 to 011. And that's it.
So rather than have a 50cm hook length of 010 or 011, you've got just a short length, but you've got that thick line, stopped angles.
There's no rules at Barston in terms of the hook length. So for example, let's say there was loads of fish there, I could literally slide that down.
I mean, that is likely to work today, isn't it? A short
hook. Oh, that'll work today, 1,000,000%, like, definitely. But at the same time, if I thought, do you know, the fish are coming on the drop, literally slide it up to where I want it.
So versatile.
Exactly, and it just means I'm versatile what I'm doing. So I'm going to chuck this out and I'm going to tell you a little bit about the why these rods are, you know, why we sort of worked on these rods, how we have. So I absolutely, it's important to say, I absolutely love my SLs, my 10 foot superior SL is like my favorite rod. It's a beautiful rod. It's very soft. And it means that once you get sort of past about 25 metres, once you get past about 25 metres, a nice line or indication there straight away, the rod starts to struggle a little bit. It's not designed for cut, for like punching hard. Oh, missed him. It's not designed for punching hard. It's not designed for that. But today, you can see, I wanted to fish a little bit further because we're up and down the banks. There's a road behind us. I wanted to...
it's quite an in-your-face wind as well.
I was going to say, the wind's a bit naughty. So the Ascension range is designed differently. The Ascension range is designed to have nice, soft, forgiving tips, really soft tips. I've got, you know, brake tips, as some people would refer them. So effectively, when you get a bike, the tip sort of, everything goes, it's really clear. There is no like, is that a bite, isn't it a bite? It's super soft. And that transitions into the rod. So the top, if you look at the top of this rod.
Just lift it up a little bit. Yes.
You see that in the sunlight? Yeah. So look, tip's really soft, but when I try and pull at an angle, it's quite difficult, but I do it there. The rod is bending all the way in the top there, look.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can see that on the camera. That, yeah. And then from that last joint, look
got
how much
meat,
look how much it sort of like stiffens up there. So if I hooked a carp today, I'm gonna man a carp, no problem. But more importantly, the winter strike is right in my face. So it's doing right in my face. I'm gonna need to punch this feeder, and I just couldn't do it with a soft rod. But by having a little bit more meat, I'm absolutely eating it up. That's the same with all the rods, Joe. So you can see I've got the method one. I've got a banjo set.
What's that, 12-foot one?
That is the 3.6 meter. It's a little gem, that rod is. I'll tell you now, because it's the same thing. I mean, it's sticked up at about 60 meters today, and it's absolutely smashing it. You know, no
it's
issues
still got
whatsoever.
That soft tip.
Yeah, you get the you can read all the bite and see everything really nice, and then when you pick up the fish, if it's a small fish, it'll just almost bounce on the softer end of the rod. But then if you get a bigger fish, you've got that play, you know. For example,
I used that one on the Trent in the summer, and it was beautiful. So
yeah,
nice.
It's a
just
beautiful,
a lovely rod.
I'm so happy with these range of rods. You know, when we design fishing rods, we've had some great rods, and we always do have great rods, but things always move on, things always develop. And when you're fishing, you always look for little things that you can tweak and improve. And obviously these rods are like what I'm calling like a cost-effective range. I mean, we've all been talking about it this morning. Prices are going up. Everything's becoming more expensive. You know,
in life, yeah.
In life, you know, fuel, gas, everything like that. So these rods haven't been done at the super expensive range of the spectrum. That, you know, they start at just over £100. So, you know, they really are what I believe for the actual rods they are. They're like a cost-effective rod, if you like, you know. So.
Beautiful actions, and obviously you spent a long time. It's funny because just the other day, a memory on Facebook popped up of us testing. It was me, Robbie, and Baptiste from France.
Oh yeah.
Testing him on this venue 2 years ago. These rods.
Yes.
And it just shows you how long these things take a long time, don't they?
Oh yeah, no, it's been. This was the whole of COVID. We worked on these rods, didn't we? You know, that was what we were doing. We were making sure that they're right. I mean, they are beautiful, beautiful rods. And certainly as we come out of winter, it's the sort of rod that I'm going to be using for pretty much everything. You know, I'm going to, they're 3.2 metre to 4 metre. So there is literally something to cover every single bit of your fishing. That's what I think so nice about them, if I'm being perfectly honest. So all I need to do now is actually sort the fishing out today. I mean, I've only just started really, but I think I've caught about a dozen skimmers already, and
yeah, it doesn't help when I'm walking around.
You know, maybe I need a shorter hook length, maybe I need a longer hook length. That's all the fishing. That's the fishing. I can't.
Do you know what I really like about your setup, Ainley? Like with that sliding setup.
Yeah.
If you was to think I could do a shorter hook length, you'd either have another rod set up, you'd have to change your whole hook length.
Yeah.
With this, you could literally change it in 10 seconds, try it for one cast, didn't work, slide it back up again.
Yeah, 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 absolutely.
Do you know what I mean? It's so non-committal, isn't it?
It's absolutely, that's what it is. Non-committal, great word, Joe. That's what I believe it does. I believe it gives you the opportunity, because we all know that sometimes fish come in our peg and they're a little bit chaotic, and like that shorter hook length is amazing. But often what happens is after you catch a few on it, almost like gimme fish, they calm down, they want a bit, but they need a longer hook length so they can have a bit more time to pick the bait up and munch on it really before you actually end up catching them. So you know, that's why I think that's so important. But I want to really stress, these aren't like skimmer roach rods. Because they've got the strength, the idea is if this goes round now with a 6 pound carp, I'm gonna be in charge of it the whole time. Yeah. You know, if it goes round with a 3 pound bream,
they're just nice all round fishing rods.
Yeah, that's exactly they're all round feeder rods. They're a rod that you can do for everything. The idea of the broken lengths, if you like, if the sort of 20 centimeter intervals, is that you can pick a rod that you go, do you know, I go to Barston all the time and I love fishing that length, and you can do it. So that's the nice thing about it.
And talk to me a little bit about the tips, because they're a little bit different to Superior tips as well, aren't they?
The tips are 2.5 mil.
So they will fit the Superior rods.
Yeah, absolutely. So they fit
and
Superior.
And vice versa.
And Superior tips are fantastic. What Superior tips do, they fast taper. So in the first, like, two rings, if you like, the tip is quite soft, but then it sort of strengthens up quite quickly. And the reason I think that's so important is, for example, if you're fishing somewhere where there's a lot of tow, you can come to bass and there's a lot of tow. So you can use that sort of tip. You can put a tip in that almost sort of strengthens itself a bit quicker. It's great for mono, for example. But when you're fishing with braid, I believe that you see a lot more. So you need your tip to be softer for longer, if that makes sense. So, you know, when the fish picks it up, you're almost watching the bite develop rather than sort of like little indications and then a bite. So they're just, again, there's something different. So people who said, I don't like a Superior tip, you will love an Ascension tip. And if you don't like that sort of tip, you can put your Superior tips in your Ascension rod. It's up to you. But that was definitely how we wanted to do these tips.
Yeah, because it's worth saying as well that, you know, this had a lot of input from Europe as well. Obviously, you had a massive part with these rods, but the European anglers who love a bit of this sort of fishing.
Oh, we bounced it back and forth. Me and Arnout bounced it back and forth all the time. And we were really, really happy with
the result.
You know, the end result. I mean, this was like, I don't think there was any rod in the range that was perfect straight away. I'm going to shorten it up now, sorry.
Is that what you're going to do? So you literally just shortened it?
Yeah, I've just shortened it up a little bit, see if there's anything a bit closer to the feeder. Yeah, you know, we sort of like, I remember the first run, I think this one actually, the 3.2, it came as exactly as we asked, but all the rest, we sort of had to, it's not quite right. We kept tweaking it just to try and get it absolutely perfect. So that's what we do, isn't it? That is our job at the end of the day. So to make sure that the fishing tackle, when it gets to you on the shelf,
is right,
is exactly right for what we want it to do. So,
just to talk about setting the tip there, I know obviously there's not a lot of depth here to work with, no depth.
Yep.
So what are you doing? You're sinking your braid?
Yeah, so once I've chucked it out, I keep my rod under the water and I just watch the braid to make sure it's sink. And if you look at how much bend I've put in the tip, I'm effectively trying to straighten everything out. I'm really big on that. I want to start with everything almost like pointing at, so like I haven't moved the feeder at all, but I want to start with everything.
So you're as direct.
And then I just slacken it off, so it's almost, the rod's almost straight. There's a bit of tow today, so it's already starting to pick it up. I know I'm starting from a straight line, if that makes sense. So I can see everything straight away. I can read it. If a fish picks it up, I'd be into it straight away. And I believe that's really good, because you can fish really direct. And then,
because with this wind and braid on this kind of day, you could end up with a horrible boat, couldn't you, before you know it?
Oh, you can. It's very easy to effectively put your rod down and you think you're tied to the fish, but you're not. You've got like a lot of slack, so it's important not to have that. You want to try and read it best you can. These little jabs and taps, Joe, sometimes it's brilliant when I'm sort of concentrating. I'll move my rod along that. See how that? Like, yeah. I've moved the rod.
It's almost
given it. Yeah, that rod rest. It's given it that little bit of slack. So because it's giving it that little bit of slack, you can see that rod there now, look how soft it is at the top.
Do you want to just lift that a tiny fraction?
Yeah.
Yeah, there.
I mean, look how soft that rod is. This is a small fish, by the way. It's like a 4 ounce, 5 ounce fish. But look how soft it is in the top. Like every little kick that's giving, I've got the forgiveness there, which is, that's exactly what I wanted the rod to do. Look at that. That is a brilliant, brilliant example of it. It's not a big fish. Look, it's a 6 ounce skimmer. So I wound that back the whole way, and the rod did all the work for me. Yet if it had been a bigger fish, you could see it was sort of strengthening all the time. Look, lovely. These are the typical little skimmers that we're fishing for today. Anything from 6 ounce to probably a pound. It's brilliant fishing, by the way. Like, if you ever want to go for a day's fishing like this, bass is brilliant for it. My van is there. So, you know. And I've had an indication or a bite pretty much every chart.
It's worth noting that you obviously shot on the hook length, yep, and got an instant result there.
Exactly, and I might only catch two or three like that, Joe. I might only catch two or three, and then I've got to think about moving it again. But
that gives you that versatility.
Yeah, that's right. You know, that's what my rig effectively gives me. So really nice.
So if anyone wants to come and do this, have you put any bait in at the start or anything like that?
That feeder that I've got on now, I started on it. So I put a medium hex mesh. I put two medium hex meshes in. Just literally cast them out and wound them in. And then I've had that winder feeder on since that time. And I've just, like I said, I've just mixed it up a little bit. Sometimes I half fill it, sometimes I fill it full. Sometimes I wedge it in a bit, sometimes I leave a bit hanging out. You have to sort of do it to the, you have to do it to what the fish are trying to tell you, if you like. You don't always know what it's going to be.
There's some fishier there again now. It's hard when, the trouble is with this sort of fishing, you've got to really concentrate on your bites, because the difference between a proper bite and not, that comes with time. You have to keep watching your rod. But if you miss, if you're not paying attention and you miss a proper bite, you can sit there for ages with your bait completely done. Whereas, but in the same breath, if you start picking up at things that aren't proper bites, then the end result is you're sort of in and out all the time and a bit too busy. I think there's obviously an onliner there. Like I said, I'm not really watching the tip, but
That's what it's all about. That's what I love about it. That's what I love about fishing for these fish. You know, you're busy. It's really, really interesting fishing. We could try shortening that again, Joe.
Go for it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I don't often fish like that. But look, just put a nice little short hook length on and see if that has an effect.
It's worth saying, you know, with having that extra meat in the rod, it makes casting those bigger hex meshes out to, for your initial feed, like, no problem, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely no problem. I mean, I am fishing 30 metres today. I'm not... No, I could fish a bit closer, but, I wanted to fish at 30 because that's where I believe today, with everything going on, it would be a sort of a nice place to fish and a regular bite. So 30 metres is too far for a 10-foot SL. You're just about getting there with an 11, but in a headwind, you know, if it gets any worse, I'm going to need to put 30 grams to fish with, you know, on to fish with. That's why I like this rod. It came about because of Tamar. I mean, at Tamar, on the second day, I fished with, on the first day, I fished with 11 foot SL, and it was lovely. A bit soft. It was all right because there was no wind. But the year before, when I fished like 30 metres, the 11 foot SL was just a bit undergunned because I needed 40 grand. I needed a 40 grams of like a really stiff wind in my face, but I didn't want my rod to be overly powerful. This rod, this 10-8 would have been absolutely perfect for it, or maybe even the 11-4.
Because that's beautiful as well, isn't it? 11-4.
Oh, so it's a beautiful rod. It's a beautiful rod. It's.
Are you now? You've shot on that hook. Are you expecting the bites to be different, or?
Yeah, I would imagine a bite on this shorter hook length to be absolutely savage. To, you know, but that's the problem. Sometimes with a shorter hook length, it's so savage that you don't actually hook your fish.
It works against you,
hence why the longer hook length can be good. But you can see there's a lot of fish there. There's a lot of indications. I need to think about the feed a little bit. You know, you have to keep on top of it all the time. It's brilliant fishing. I absolutely love it. It's fantastic stuff.
Those are indications.
Yeah, there's fish there. I mean, like I say, I'm up to 20 now. And look.
He's on.
Like that.
That's
the bite you're looking for. You're looking for that. You know, we could watch the tip the whole time there, couldn't we? You know, we could watch everything the whole time. Hold the rod up again. Look, same thing again. Look at it. It's absolutely perfect for that style of fishing.
It's working a charm today.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to be for all this sort of style of fishing, I'm going to be using these sort of rods, and you know, they're not 250, 300, 400 pound rods. You know, they give you a little bit more cost effective. You can have two of them if you know, and the quality is still brilliant. Nice handle as well. Look, that's worked nice, isn't it? Look,
I think we'll leave it there after this one.
Yeah. Got 5 metres gorge, Joe, so it was behind me here, but Lord knows where it is now. Get another one out of the side.
Great fishing.
Brilliant fishing, mate. Absolutely brilliant. You know, he's had it right down, so proper look.
Lovely.